Okay. No, they still open.
Even voor ga zo beginnen. Elmer gaat vertellen over legal and ethics. Luister even, allemaal. Elmer gaat vertellen over legal and ethics in forensics. En dat geldt natuurlijk ook voor security. Die dingen zijn een beetje onlosmakelijk met elkaar verbonden, eigenlijk. Er hoort een practica bij, er zijn een aantal opdrachten. Nou, daar vertelt Elmer zo meer over. We gaan dus ook de volatility antwoorden nog even bespreken. Die doen we ook. We blijven gewoon hier. Dat is prima te doen. Volatility hebben jullie toch gedraaid op je eigen laptop. Dus dat is wat makkelijker. En dan hoeven we ook niet in twee groepen te verdelen vandaag. Dus dat scheelt een hoop tijd. Met een beetje mabbel. Een aantal van jullie melden nog met projecten. Even voor de duidelijkheid. Je kan best je eigen project... Ik heb het misschien niet duidelijk gezegd. Je kan best een eigen project verzinnen. Dat is prima. Maar dan moet je wel een opdrachtgever vinden. Daarvoor nog steeds, intern of extern. Het is dus nadrukkelijk niet de bedoeling dat je zomaar mijn of Elmers naam opschrijft. Daar hebben wij geen uren voor. Even heel kort de bocht, daar worden we niet voor betaald. Dat klinkt wel heel oneerbiedig, maar we hebben gewoon 0 uren daarvoor staan voor die projectbegeleiding. Dus dan hebben wij op een gegeven moment straks 15 projecten die we moeten begeleiden. En zijn we de hele week projecten aan het begeleiden, terwijl we daar eigenlijk geen tijd voor hebben. Dus proberen als het even kan een externe opdrachtgever te vinden. Een aantal van jullie... er zijn een paar projecten die wij wel zelf aanbieden natuurlijk. Dan is het natuurlijk vrij makkelijk, die begeleiden we wel. Maar dan is dat natuurlijk duidelijk en dan is dat al geregeld. Dus pas op dat je dat niet zomaar invult. Want als de afstudeercommissie dat dan goedkeurt, dan zitten wij denk ik zo... Wat? Sindsdien doen wij dat ook. Dus graag even in overleg. Proberen dus een externe opdrachtgever te vinden. En bij voorkeur een project dat kant en klaar is. Want ook daar krijgen we nog een paar vragen over. Dus... Goed, zijn er voor de rest vragen tot nu toe? Over de miner, dringende zaken? Oké. Elmer is begonnen met het converteren van die videomaterialen van de afgelopen week. Alleen dat duurt 12 uur per film, continu, op een i7. Dus daarom is het niet zo heel snel. Maar het gaat nu wel via een automatische toetsie, begrijp ik. Dus...
Ja, ik heb een ander toertje inderdaad en dan lijkt het sneller te gaan.
Dus, dan lijkt het sneller te gaan, maar daarom duurt dat lang. Het is even wat gedoe. Om het te belasten. Volgens mij zijn we voor de rest klaar.
Oké.
Kun je beginnen?
Ja. Sure.
Ik heb tikken op. Bye bye. Auw. Geef nog een mooie spike op de audio. Dus zinken waar het beeld en de audio gelijk. Welcome all. Today we will talk about ethics and legal. Let me close the door. An important part in forensics and security, what is allowed, what is not allowed, what should we do in certain circumstances. We will look into three cases and have a look at what we will do in such cases, because like I said, when you deal with security, maybe we would like to scan for viruses, maybe. But if we would like to scan for viruses, we need to have a look in maybe email attachments. And is that allowed? Maybe I need to... we saw the lecture from the ING, where the ING bank was looking at the browser history of their clients. Can we do that? Should we do that? This is all very, and these are, he said, Jan Joris Verrijzen, the lecturer from ING, he said, I'm talking more with legal than with my technical guys. And this is why legal issues and ethical issues are very important in this context. I am not a lawyer, I'm not a meester in Dutch, I don't know. I don't have a degree in law, so I don't know a lot about law, but I know enough to give you a short introduction into law, into how things work, and same goes for ethics. Ethics is a very difficult subject that rushes to philosophy, the great philosophers. But we don't need to go that deep. The aim of today is to give you a little context and to some tools to help you to make some ethical decisions. When you are asked to scan emails of people, for example, you would be in charge, the administrator here at the HVA, and the HVA would ask you as the administrator, could you do a scan of all the email from the students and see if there's any references to, I don't know, in Holland, for whatever reason. Can I do that? Would I do that? What would you do in that circumstance? Well, that's what we're going to talk about today. We follow this book, Ethics and Business, from Ronald Jurissen, a professor from in Holland. I know. Well, he's actually a professor at Nyenrode University, but Nyenrode is part of in Holland now, not in Den Bosch. So he is they are part of in Holland, and I like his views on ethics. So that's, and he has a very practical approach. So that's why we are using this book. And if you would like to read more on this topic, I can really recommend this book. Okay, cybercrime. Let's have a look at cybercrime. What is cybercrime? Can anyone give me some examples of cybercrime?
DDoS.
DDoS is definitely something related to cybercrime. It's DDoS. There was a DDoS attack now on a NATO site, huh? Of course, you have to understand that this is all a facade. The real NATO servers are not connected to the internet. I mean, this is the website of NATO, NATO.int, is just a regular website hosted by some ISP somewhere. And if they get attacked, the website itself has nothing to do with NATO in itself, nothing to do with the NATO infrastructure. So it was never really under attack. However, they were DDoS attacked, and would you say that the DDoS attack is a very serious attack?
We are talking about ethics and law. Now,
it's more like a statement.
Let's assume that you would be accused of it, or that you are asked to represent someone that has been accused of a DDoS attack, and I would be the judge. How would you defend it? How would you mitigate what was done? Would you have arguments that you say, it's only a DDoS attack? Or maybe someone else? Is a DDoS attack very bad? Very bad?
Depends on the client infrastructure, I think.
Oh, this is interesting. Depends on the client.
If it's just an informative website, and you bring that down, how can you assess what the damage is? But if it's a web shop, then you can say, okay, I lost money because of you. I couldn't sell because of you.
This is interesting. And we will get to this further on in the slides. Apparently, there are consequences. And maybe the consequences are part in our weighing of what is bad or not, what is it good or not. Because ethics, as we will see, is more or less about good and bad, right and wrong. And in this case, well, if it's only informative, in general, if we look at the whole scope of cyber attacks, do you think that the DDoS attack is a very bad one? What would you say? Anyone an idea on that? This is definitely something that we need to think about. Yeah, I have some.
I think it's pretty bad because if you target your attack strategy, you could disable the infrastructure that could be of use for government. Or...
Yeah, you could disable an infrastructure. Yeah. So it's if we look at the CIA, the three sides of the security triangle, then which ones do we attack with the DDoS attack?
Mostly CIA, FBI, and the FBI. And
No. I mean confidentiality, integrity, and availability.
Availability.
Is confidentiality ever a problem?
Yes.
With DDoS?
No.
And integrity?
No.
So it's mainly availability. So we attack the availability side of the infrastructure. And this is why I would say, I don't know I would not classify it as a super serious bad kind of thing. I think there's far worse things out there than a DDoS attack. However, and that you are exactly right with, it depends on who the target is. If we target, for example, Amazon or KPN, KPN was under attack during a live broadcast, I believe, 1 or 2 years ago. There was something, a big event, and KPN was broadcasting it live over the internet. Well, not KPN, I mean, KPN was the service provider. I mean, it was some event that which was broadcasted live over the internet by KPN, and it was DDoSed. So it caused a lot of harm, and in that case you could say, well, it did cause harm, but integrity and confidentiality were never really targeted. You don't really typically target that with a DDoS attack. So I would say, I think there are far worse things out there. For example, we're in the cybercrime.
Zeus,
yeah, that's a nice one. And how is Zeus worse than a DDoS attack?
Because you target personal, like financials of people.
Finances of people, yeah. So I steal money.
That's the point. Yeah.
Sounds worse than definitely sounds worse. So I think we can come up with a list. And for example, there's piracy. It's a form of cybercrime where the main thing is copyright infringement. So someone has a copyright on a product and we copy it. Trespassing, unauthorized entering of computer systems or computer networks.
For a long time that was not really illegal in the Netherlands, for as far as I know. I'm looking at Arning. Now it is, but for a long time this was, for as far as I know, this was like a gray area. Now it's not a gray area. It's very well known that you should not, you cannot even tamper with security. If there is some form of security and you try to bypass that security, that in itself is already an offense in the Netherlands. So anyway, vandalism, the DDoS attack, disrupting the availability and usability of a computer system or network, where that's a DDoS attack. Terrorism, terrorist attack on a computer system or network.
It's also basically a bit intertwined, right?
It's also, what, sorry?
If a terrorist makes a DDoS.
Yeah, there's overlap. I mean, they're not mutually exclusive things. You can say, oh, let's pick a few. Huh? Let's do this one and this one. Yeah, it's like a shopping mall for cyber criminals. Huh? Terrorism could be a DDoS attack, definitely. Yeah. And with the DDoS attack, you can maybe do more serious harm. Because, for example, we could do a DDoS attack on some sort of guidance system. For example, the ILS of airplanes landing at Schiphol Airport. I can DDoS the ILS, and then all of a sudden the pilots have to land the airplanes themselves. How did it work? Quickly, get the manual. How to land your airplane? How to land your Airbus A320? Step one.
Okay. Or a DDoS to cover something else up.
To cover something. Oh, yeah, very good. That's what the same thing with bank robbers. The good bank robbers, they create a big incident in the city somewhere else, far away from the bank, so that all the police goes that way, and then they rob the bank. And then there's no police because they're all at the other side of the city. And it's the same thing what you can do if I want to do something under the, cloak of darkness, or how would you say that? Hidden. I can maybe DDoS some surveillance system or something like that, or something like that. Yeah. Oh, very good, very good. Yeah. So there's a lot of, and we see that criminals, and terrorism, I don't think we have seen a lot of terrorism yet, cyber terrorism. I don't know. I don't know many examples at least, but we see that cyber criminals are using more and more advanced techniques like these things, like you said.
That's an ethical question. Would you consider the attack of the Iranian nuclear cyclotrons?
Yes.
For the uranium, would you consider that as an act of terrorism?
Oh, that's an interesting thing.
An ethical question.
Definitely an ethical question. You asked me personally, would I consider it a terrorist attack? I think I would, yes. And I can tell you my reasoning, but I would prefer to do that at the end of this class, because we have a similar question. Not that same question, otherwise I would not have said it. But we have a similar question here. And the reason I say yes is because I follow a train of I follow a method to decide whether or not something is the act can be considered in one way or the other. And I think that if you follow that method, you would come to the same conclusion. And you would say yes. In this case, I think we could consider it a terrorist attack. But terrorism. That's the interesting thing about terrorism. Terrorism is a matter of perspective. For the Nazis, the freedom fighters of the Netherlands. How do we just say that? What was the name?
The
resistance. Yeah, the resistance were definitely considered terrorists. But I mean, for the Dutch, they were considered freedom fighters, or I don't know, the Liberation Army. It's a matter of perspective. Theft. Theft of data, definitely, cybercrime. Espionage, ooh, hot at the moment. Is it ethical? Interesting, very interesting. The whole Snowden thing, very interesting question. If you ask me, Snowden went, in my opinion, way too far. That's my personal opinion. But it started out as a very interesting thing, because he intrinsically believed that the whole Snowden case is also, I think, based in ethics, where he could not live with what he was doing. It is exactly the position that you could find yourself in at one day, that you work for an agency and you're doing things and you don't agree, and then what do you do? And I think it started out as a sort of good ethical thinking thing, but it ended, I mean, when he went to China and was telling the Chinese all about the espionage about the US, I think, well, that's he's considered a military personnel. It's probably crossing the line there. I mean, but I don't know. Fraud involving a computer system or network. This is also a big one at the moment. I don't have the data, the exact data, but if I would have to guess, I think, piracy is of course big, but it's getting less and less for lots of reasons. Trespassing, well, it's big if we consider botnets, if we consider that trespassing, this is a big. Vandalism, not so big. Terrorism, I don't think it's big. I don't believe that. I don't know. I know very little examples. Theft, this is big. Theft, and that combined with espionage, because they go hand in hand. We see a lot of espionage based on theft of intellectual property, and even in the Netherlands we have a special agency which was created to steal intellectual property from other countries. So we do it too, but we do it because all the others do it. Okay, let's have a look. Let's move to legislation. And this is the EU. We are part of the EU. And let me take it away. Because I would like to ask you, how does the EU work? Legislation? Are there European laws, or is it all just a bit fair? Oh, thank you. Oh, but I don't have a free port, so it's at all. Thank you. It's a Mac, huh? It has two USB sockets and next time. And I have a remote, actually. I should have a remote. Yeah. Yeah, it works. Oh, my battery's empty. It says here my battery's empty. That's why the screen turns dark. But I have a remote. Okay. So we are part of the EU. Does anyone have any idea how it works? This is interesting because how does it work?
Well, we send money to Brussels.
We send money to Brussels. Yes, we do. A lot.
That's how it works.
That's how it works. I know.
And you get nothing back.
And we get nothing. Well, we get a lot back. No. We get a lot of it back. But we do. I think we pay among the most of the per person. Yeah. So yes, we do pay all the money. But they do stuff with the money. For one thing, they move all the time, right, between Brussels and Strasbourg. Yeah. How often is that? Once a year, twice a year, once every month? I don't even know.
Three.
But they move all the time?
Yeah, every week.
How often?
Every week, obviously.
Every week?
No, every 2 weeks.
Every 2 weeks? I know it's often. I see Google, so I'm sure we can look that up. But that's what they do with it. But legislation. First question, does the EU create laws at all? Do they make laws?
Yes.
Yes, they do. Do they make a lot of laws?
Yes, probably.
on another idea?
They try to.
So
they make laws, but they're not generally accepted as the law.
You said they make laws, but no one accepts them. Or yeah? This is interesting. No, we will see. There's the EU is a very interesting thing because we are all sovereign states. We are independent states. We have our own. Our government is the highest body of government in our country. The EU in itself is not higher than our government. We only have an agreement with the EU, but we can get out of the EU at any time. It's just an agreement with other sovereign states. And of course, if we don't do as we should by the EU, then probably we will be kicked out at some point. So, but it's not as if there is a higher body of law above our government. But they do make laws, they do. And, I was here. No, let's first ask a few questions, because I'm intrigued by the fact that we get so little answers so far. I know there's something like the EU Parliament. What is the EU Parliament? Any idea? This is our... This is shocking. I know, it's the same for me. I have no clue. I mean, I know a little bit, but it's all very difficult. There's so many bodies of government. But we have a parliament. Do we vote people in that parliament?
In the parliament, yes. But
yes.
The other people there, we don't vote for.
The other people, we don't vote. True. So apparently we have a parliament and we vote the parliament. But there's more. I'll just put up the picture because I feel that otherwise probably we won't get many answers. There is, this is us. The white bar here, I know it's a bit PVV, and this is only a joke you will understand in the Netherlands, but this white bar is us. Huh? And as you can see, we elect or vote. We vote for the national parliament, and we vote for the European parliament. Then we are done. We are, okay, now it's up to the others. Then the national parliament, they select a government. In the Netherlands at the moment, this is VVD and the PvdA and the PvdD. That's it? Is there one more?
CU?
No, I think it's just the two, isn't it? PvdA and PvdD? I think it's two of them, two parties.
Oh, it's,
and the others just.
Didn't they have you need to have like more than 6%, I think.
Yes, and they don't.
Yes, so that it's like a nail, I don't know what it is.
Yeah, they need other votes as well, otherwise they can. But the difference is that the government, they are actually, as you can see here, executive branch, they do the work. And so you have, it's called a minister here. I think in America it's called a secretary. And you have a secretary of education and a secretary of inland affairs and a secretary of defense or I don't know what you call it. And a secretary of, you have a lot of ministers, minister for this, minister for that. And they are elected and they are called the government because they do the work. And the others just talk. They have to do it. And you have a head of state, which is Mark, our Mark. And this is true for all the European states, all the European countries. We also have a European Parliament, and we have a president. What's his name?
Schulz.
Is that Schulz? I have no idea. Man, that is Barroso, isn't it? Barroso? Is it Schultz? What was it? I don't know. Well, apparently there's a president of the European Parliament. All the heads of state, Mark and all the others, they together form the European Council. And they also have a president, and that's that Belgian guy, isn't it?
Van Rompuy.
Yeah, Van Rompuy. Yeah, Van Rompuy, Belgian guy. They elect, or they choose, the European Commission. That's the tough people, like David Smith Cruz, who makes Microsoft pay. You don't obey to my word. You don't put Firefox in Microsoft. 5 billion euros per fine. I don't know how much was it. I don't know. It's a big fine that she gave to Microsoft. I think 1 billion or something for not having Firefox in Microsoft. Something like that. So they elect the commission. As you can see, the blue parts are doing all the work. So you have the national governments, they do the work. The European Council, they come up with laws. Did they come up with laws? Let's see, proposes. Yeah, so the proposing is the, yeah, so the European Council, the heads of state, they propose laws. They say, I think we should have a law on cybercrime. It's a good example. We should have a law on cybercrime because all the botnets and everything, so we should have a law. That goes to the European Commission, and the European Commission, they write it, because the council is just the head of, is Mark, and Mark doesn't have much time because he has to go out, huh? And has to go to the national security, the nuclear security summit in Den Haag, but he can come that far that he says we need a law on cybercrime, and then he gives that to the European Commission, and they go come up with the cybercrime law. So they start writing, and they come up with a proposal, and they say, well, we think that there should be this law. Then there's the European Parliament, and they look at it, we have some changes that we would like to make. Well, and then this goes back and forth a bit. There's also a council of what is called here ministers, but in America I think it's secretaries. If the law in this case is about cybercrime, that would be considered by the council of secretaries of inland affairs. Are those the ones who would think about cybercrime? Is that national safety police? I think in the Netherlands is a Minister van Binnenlandse Zaken. I think the Secretary of Inland Affairs is the one who's the boss of police and legislation. So all the ministers van Binnenlandse Zaken, all the secretaries of Inland Affairs, they also have their look at the law, and it goes back and forth a bit until they agree. They say, okay, now we have a law that we like, and then the law comes into effect. But what kind of law? There's all sorts of different laws in the EU. Does anyone know a few of them? Different kind of laws in the EU? Did you see the spots? No? Okay, let's go. This is shocking a bit. I mean, we have to obey them and we have no clue. There are two treaties. They establish the EU. So there's a Treaty of Maastricht and a Treaty of Rome or something. I don't know exactly. But that's a treaty. And all the European countries signed it. Basically, that's the foundation of how we work together. And that's basically the EU. It's nothing more than an agreement that we work together. Then there's so-called directives. And directives are mandatory guidelines for state law. And
This is, although there's only, this is the number of directives that are out there. So this is in 2012. So you see there's about 2,000 directives. And this is, although it's very little, this is the typical thing, the typical way that that they would prefer of how to create a law. They would say, we want you to make a law considering, for example, cybercrime. There is a directive on cybercrime. And the directive itself is not a law. The directive is an order, more or less, to every state to make a law following these guidelines. And the reason is that the country is sovereign, and the highest body of legislation, more or less, is the courts within the country itself, within the state itself. So it's best if it's a law related to the country, because then it fits nice in the model of how law works within that country. If you create a European law, you would need to go to a European court, and the European court doesn't like to do cases. They like the local courts to do all the stuff, to do the work. They don't want to mess with that, because it's also a bit tricky on it gets all there, as we can see here. If I ask about the EU, I see all glazed eyes. I have no idea. I mean, who is the president? Is there a parliament? What do they do? I have no clue. So we would like to stay away from there. We would like to do it as locally as possible. Then there are international treaties, binding laws for all states. So they can, for example, we have the treaty with the United States, which is which we don't like very much, about the sharing of data. That if you travel to the United States, then you have to give up all your personal data, and that's a binding, that's a treaty signed by the EU with the American government, and that's binding for everyone in the EU. So if I go to the United States, then they will, the United States government will get all my data and more. And that's fine, but that's just one example. There's 5,000 of them. Also with all sorts of countries like India on trade and you name it. There are regulations, binding general laws. So these are general laws that we need to obey to. And there are decisions. The difference between a regulation and a decision is a decision is typically for a very select group of entities. For example, a decision can be that importers of tobacco must make sure that the tobacco is only sold to 18 plus. I don't know. It's a fake. I mean, it's a non-existent decision, but that could be a decision. Because it's specific for importers of tobacco. It's not a general, it doesn't apply to me because I'm not an importer. So it's not aimed at me. And sometimes the European Union, well sometimes, 16,000 times so far, the European Union creates a binding law specific for a target group. Because in that target group something goes wrong. And the last one, verdicts from the European Court of Justice. There's 12,000 EU cases so far. But as I said, the EU Court of Justice doesn't like to do cases. I mean, they prefer to have everything dealt with in the country itself. So typically, if a case comes for the EU Court of Justice, the judge will say, well, I rule that a local court must make a decision on this. So,
Yeah, that's that happens.
There's a data protection directive, and this is interesting because we will see there are differences between the EU and America. In the EU, when it comes to personal data, we the EU view on this is that it is my data, it's my personal data, and anyone having my data needs to make sure that it is protected because it's my data, my name, my birth date, my bank account, my bank transactions, it's all mine. And of course the bank knows this, but the bank doesn't own this data, the bank only more or less borrows the data from me because it's my data. And this is the view from the European Union. So it says personal data should not be processed unless there's transparency, so we know what data is. And we have that in the Netherlands, so we have the law, we have that agency, what's it called, Arnie? Persoonsgegevens.
College bescherming
de persoonsgegevens.
College for the protection of personal data.
Yeah, so there is a specific agency which is responsible for protecting our data and administering our data, the use of our data.
If the laws enforced properly.
Yeah, to see it all. And if I store data of someone else, I need to report that to that agency. You need to fill out a form and you say, I am storing the data that is exempt is only name, address, and birth date. I think that's the only thing you're allowed to store from someone else. And if you store anything else in a database or something, you need to inform them about it. It doesn't cost anything, but you need to fill out the form. And it's mandatory in the Netherlands, in the EU, that you do that. And in the Netherlands, you fill out the form and you say, I store this from people. And you need to fill out what you store. That's on the form. You need to tell them why you store it, because you need to have a good reason for storing it, otherwise you're not allowed to. And proportionality is, you also, that's not on the form, but it needs to be proportional to the use. So I want to, I store that data with a certain aim, with a certain goal. And that goal has to justify why you stored that data, because I cannot just store all the data just because I can or I want to. The goal needs to be proportional. With the form that you fill out, you also need to tell them how the person of which the data is can know what data is in your database. So, for example, if I would like to know which data Rainbow Bank has stored about me, I can contact that agency and I can request a form, and the form will say, well, Rainbow Bank stores this and this and this data from all its clients, and if you want to retrieve your file, your data, you need to do this. This is the procedure that you need to do, and this is the cost. They are allowed to charge you reasonably, so like 20 euros, 25 euros. But I can request it, and mandatory, they have to give me all my data to show what they have stored about me in their data. That's mandatory. So it's all about transparency. The subject has given consent, but you know how it goes. You go to the Rainbow Bank, you get like a stack of forms, small print, and you sign it, well, it's in there. Yeah, you store everything. This is how that works, but you have to give consent. It must be necessary for performance or for the contract, necessary for legal compliance, necessary for, well, maybe because I, for example, the HVA is my employer, and they must store my ID and my diplomas. they must, because if there is an inspection, then they are obliged to provide that information at the time of inspection. So that's why they are legally, for legal compliance, the HVA must store a copy of my ID and a copy of my diploma. For example, necessary to protect the subject, necessary for performance or public interest, necessary for legitimate interest, except when overridden by fundamental rights. I have the right for deletion. In the EU, I can demand that the Rainbow Bank deletes all the information they have about me. I can demand, of course, then they will also cancel my account, but I can demand. And they must oblige. Whether they do, it's a different thing. Legitimate purpose. Personal data can only be processed for specified, explicit, and legitimate purpose, and may not be processed any further. The last thing is also important. You're not allowed to do more than is strictly necessary. And about proportionality, only as far as adequate, relative, and not excessive, must be accurate and kept up to date or erased. This is important. This is funny, yeah, because a lot of people are registered at the, what is it, if you want a loan, the, what's that register called, Arne? If you want a loan, your
Beker,
yeah, Bureau Krediet Registratie, yeah. So the agency that stores all the data of loans. And a lot of people are not able to get a loan, to acquire a loan or a mortgage, because the data stored there is not up to date. So they say, oh no, no, he has a lot more debt than you actually, or they even worse, they mix you with someone else. Identification data should not be stored longer than necessary. Extra restrictions for sensitive personal data, or like your sexual preference. It's pretty sensitive data sometimes, so that's even more restricted to store. Only if you can really prove that you really need that. Legal decisions may not be based on pure automatic processing, and appeal must be provided for automated legal decisions. This is probably for these. These little boxes by the road, speed cameras. The general data protection regulation is enforced in the EU. This is a strange one, because it applies worldwide. This is a bit weird. I mean, this, to me, it's weird that. That a law can extend itself beyond the borders of a country or a region, because it's a bit weird that we would make Dutch law in France, for example. To me, it's a strange concept. But the reality is that the world is a global marketplace. And the world is very small, it's a virtual world, so location and action are becoming virtual. Someone from Asia could rob someone in Amsterdam. That's someone in Seoul can steal money from someone in Amsterdam. And this is a new concept, because 20 years ago that would be very difficult to do a thing like that. And now it's very simple to do a thing like that. So that means we need some form of international laws, and we don't have a good structure. Well, we have a structure for that, but not everyone wants to work with that. So now you see that countries are coming up with laws that apply worldwide for some reason. A lot of countries are doing this now, which is weird, but okay, it's true. The same is true. The same is true for this regulation. It's about data from European citizens stored outside the EU. And it was, of course, this regulation was created because of the United States. That a lot of our data is stored in the United States. And as we all know, questionable things happen to our data over there. So that's the best way I can express it. And they felt the need to do something about protection. And there's an international safe harbor. There are international safe harbor privacy principles, and American companies can comply to this regulation, and then they are allowed to store data from European citizens, even in America or wherever else in the world. But they would have to comply to this regulation. Retention time must be provided, privacy by design, valid consent must be explicit, data breach has to be reported within 24 hours, this is very important. It's also now in the Netherlands, so this is a new law, but, and I think this is a very good one. Data must be deleted when consent expires automatically, and data must be in readable format to the subject. So if I request my information, they cannot just give a file of, I don't know, a SIS export file, our student information system export file, in some encrypted form. No. I need to be able to read it. Okay. The Cybercrime Directive. This is a new one.
Hot.
From the 3rd of September 2013 in legislation land. This is very hot, new. Cybercrime Directive. Directive.
Huh?
Directive. That's a book. What was the directive? Even when it's on the slide, I don't get the directive. Directive is mandatory guidelines for state law, for a country to make that law. So the directive is new. So each country now has some time to implement this directive. But this directive will also be implemented in the Netherlands. I don't think it has been implemented yet. I think they're talking about it right now. But, this will be implemented. Penalize the use of tools for committing offenses. So, for example, botnets. If you're using botnets, you will be punished. Penalized. Punished. Introduction of illegal interception of information systems as a criminal offense. So if I intercept some information, that should be illegal. That should be a criminal offense if I'm not allowed to intercept. Somehow it's improvement of European criminal justice police by, so you have to strengthen your police force. That would be nice. I have also tried to report some cybercrime things to the Dutch police. Well, up until now, they had no clue. I remember I called them two or three times, I think, when I caught a criminal attack. And I thought, well, I am under attack. I mean, I can see who it is. Well, I can see where it comes from, and I can see what they want, and it's definitely cybercrime. How do I report it? I mean, I would do the same thing if someone was breaking the windows of my car. I would go to the police and say, well, I can see who it is, I know who it is. Should you do something? And with the computer, same thing. So I call the police and I think, well, first time you have hope. You think, okay, well, there's going to be teams and I don't know, there's going to be consequences and penalization. Huh? That's what you hope for. So, nothing. I don't know. I mean, that's what the answer was when I called the, when I phoned the police. They said, oh, I have no clue what you, where to call this police. Okay. So let's. But no, not anymore. The police needs to be able to. There needs to be a police somewhere where you can go to, and report these cybercrime offenses. They need to answer within 8 hours if it's urgent. Like for example, if at KPN something big happens, and report to the police within 8 hours, you need to have an answer. Well, we have written it down, but that doesn't specify one answer. Including the obligation to collect basic statistical data on cybercrime. This is also, well, in the Netherlands this is done for up to a point. There is data on cybercrime. And there is a, on these offenses, there is a minimum of a maximum of 2 years of imprisonment. So this is a legal, it's a directive. The Netherlands needs to create a law. And this is a European directive. So the Netherlands needs to create a law which says for these crimes, the maximum imprisonment for this crime is at least 2 years. So it has a maximum. Typically in Europe you would say for this crime the maximum penalization that you can get is, I don't know, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. You need to give a number, and the number should not be lower than 2. However, if things get worse and aggravating circumstances, a significant number of information systems have been affected by the use of a tool. So if a botnet infects, I don't know, 300,000 computers, I would say that's significant, then it is not 2 years, but 3 years is the maximum. So in the Netherlands, it will always come out to what? 20 hours community service? But at least there is a maximum. There's a maximum. If you are really, really bad, causing serious damage, whatever that may be, 5 years. 5 years. You can go to prison for 5 years. Against the critical infrastructure, then, for example, a nuclear power plant, 5 years. You can go to prison for 5 years. Let's have a look at the United States. U.S. privacy laws, or as they would probably say, privacy laws. Laws. In America, it's not so much about protecting your data. It's it's more about the concept of privacy, as you can see. You're not allowed to enter a computer system. If you somehow hack into or break into a computer system, of course in America, I mean, they could probably hang you for this. They don't need the directive for all. You need at least a maximum imprisonment of 3 years. 3 years? You get 3 years if you have the wrong eye color. I need to cut this out. But typically, jail sentences are not a problem. Public disclosure of truthful private information. So, even though it's true, if it's private, if for example, let's say my sexual preference, I like a cacti. For example, maybe that's whenever you see a forest, I don't. Even if it's true, maybe you're not allowed to disclose that because it's private. That's not something. Publication of facts that produce a false lie. This is of course, this is American. Huh? This is a false light means that you give a wrong image of someone. And you can say something that, which is all true, but which might make people believe that something, I don't know. Kind of a false light. I have no example. This is I try, but I think you can all think of something. Unauthorized use to obtain benefits. In America, it is benefits is like an uitkering. And if you maybe you use someone else's social security number to get benefits. That's not allowed. Of course not. I mean, same here. But we can see this is a different approach to. Not a completely different approach to the data thing. There is something HIPAA or HIPAA or whatever you want to call it, that controls who has access to medical data, because they also have the EPD, the electronic patient document file, the
database,
whatever. So they have the same problem: who can access my data? FACTA list no more than 5 digits of your credit card. Because all the credit card details got stolen. Still in America, I was told, the biggest problem is waiters in restaurants writing down your credit card details when you give your credit card to pay. And they immediately go on eBay. So there's a law which says that you are never allowed to write more than 5 digits of the credit card. COPPA, websites must have parents' consent for under 13 for certain sites, for certain things. So, but it's interesting. Bless you. It's interesting that this is a completely different approach. It's very, and we will see in a few slides that America has completely different view on law, and that's why the law is very different. There's a lot of U.S. cybercrime laws. Here's a whole list, but they're very specific, and this is because of the roots are in how the American law system works. So we see, for example, fraud with ID authentication and information, aggravated ID theft. If it's aggravated, there probably it goes from 30 to 50 years. That's a different kind of aggravation, but still. Fraud with access devices, fraud with computers, fraud with email, very detailed. This is because of how the American law works, as we will see. Fraud by wire, radio, or TV. Apparently by tablet, a problem, but wire, radio, TV, big problem. Mischief to communication lines, stations, or systems. Importation of or transportation of obscene matters. In the Netherlands this is not a big thing, but in America it is. Transportation of obscene matters for sale. Even better, worse. Sexual exploitation of children, of course, is a bad thing. Sexual exploitation of minors. Similar, with a different category. Child porn. Domain names to deceive minors. This is all within the same group. Child exploitation, and of course, in the Netherlands we don't have separate laws for it. There's just the one law that covers all these things, and that's because of, again, of how the systems work. They are fundamentally different. Transmit information about a minor. Infringement of copyright. Copyright offenses in America. So you copied one MP3 file, $100,000 fine. This is how it works in America. Unauthorized publication, interception of wire, oral, or electronic communication, disclosure. Now, I don't know. I mean, does the NSA fall under these laws? We already see that the American laws are very different, very precise, very specific, than the EU laws, the Dutch laws, and it is because there are different systems of law. There are There's civil law and common law. These are the two big ones. Then you have mixed systems, where you have both. And you have, of course, the Sharia law, the Islamic law. And it's mostly about chopping off hands and stoning and, I know very little about Sharia law, but it's really wise man, typically, I think. Wise people who make decisions. I saw a documentary about it, of how that worked. I think in Afghanistan, although it's not, is it on the list? Where is Afghanistan? Here? Is that Afghanistan? I think so. No,
that's Iran.
This is Iran. Yeah. That's Afghanistan here? Yeah? This is Iran. You see how much I know. This is, what's this, Saudi Arabia or something? This you know, I'm proud of you. So, I thought Afghanistan was much bigger, but and this is Pakistan and that's India. Yeah, I thought Afghanistan was much bigger than that. Okay, so this is Afghanistan. I think I saw a documentary about Islamic law in Afghanistan and how that worked, where you have the wise men of the village together, and they decide on what will happen with the person, like a team of judges. But I know very little about Islamic law. I also know very little about civil law, but I know a little bit more of how the systems work. In the Netherlands and in Europe, we use civil law. And that's based on the Roman law and French Roman law, Napoleon, that kind of law system. And as you can see, the UK has a different system. So it follows a different law system. In America, again, follows the same system as the UK and Canada as well, except for the French. Yes. And as you can see here, this is... Is that where Louisiana is? No, I think Louisiana is a little bit mirror. I don't know. There's a little brown spot there at the bottom of America. I know, I say bad things. I know. This is Texas. I think this is Louisiana, where Katrina was. That's also French. This is Quebec, French area. They also okay. And this is where's Suriname? Is this Suriname? No.
Yeah,
that's
Suriname.
Suriname? Yeah, we have someone from Suriname.
Venezuela.
And what's this?
France-Guyana.
France-Guyana?
Guyana?
Yeah. But that has a British law, huh?
Yeah,
France-Guyana.
9 hours vliegen.
9 hours flying. Next to France-Guyana? What's next to France-Guyana?
Suriname.
There, in the middle. There.
Yes, yeah. In the middle.
Ah, nice. I need to go there, huh? Ah, nice. You learn a little bit about the world. Okay, so what's different about these laws? Common law is an adversarial system. So we have party A, and party A says, and we have a party B, and party B says, so they are against each other. And the judge is in the middle, and Solomon, give me the baby and a sword, and I will solve. That's the adversarial system. And it's based on cases, and that's why you see that entire list of very specific cases. There must have been a case where there was a fraud with an ID. They say, okay, let's make a law. And there was a fraud with an email. Okay, let's make a law. Because it's based on cases. And the judge will look at the, well, not only the judge, also the two people that are against each other will look at the past and will say, well, for example, I don't know, he killed his neighbor because his neighbor looked at his wife, something like that. And could be a true story in America, for sure. And with one of his 100 guns that he had on his belt. And he says, well, if we go back in time, we have the case of, I don't know, Zork, a caveman. And he clubbed his neighbor when the other guy was looking at his wife. And, well, that was all fine. And he did not have to go to prison. Because, well, and then the judge can say, well, he's got a point. He's got a point there. And then the other says, well, oh, but if we look at the case, you hear that a lot. When you listen, I never watched it, but I think there's a show, LA Law or something, or there's a lot of shows about lawyers and stuff.
Yeah.
Apparently no one is watching those shows, okay. But whenever I flick through the channels and I happen to stop long enough on one of these shows, which is about court cases, I often hear things like, well, in the case, I don't know, thingy against thingy, the judge ruled this because of that. They always give examples out of the past. And the judge says, okay, well, you came up with 10 examples, you came up with 8 examples, it seems that he wins, or she, whatever. That's common law. Civil law is based on the letter of the law. So you write things down in books up front, and it's what is called an inquisitorial system based on rights. So we have books of law, big books, and past cases are not so important because, of course, they are important. I mean, they're also used. And it's not a black and white area. It's not that in America they only base their verdict on past cases. That's not how it works. They also use writings. And it's the same thing here in Europe. It's not that we only base every case on the books, on the written law. We also look at the past cases. But it's what has the most weight. And the most weight in a civil law system is the letter of the law, and the judge has way more a position of where he tries to match the situation to the written word. So the judge knows the written word, should know the written word. And he also questions the people that are in court to try to fit them in the framework of the letter of the law. So he asks people, did you do this? Did you do this? Or what would you have done in that situation? And these are things that the judge needs to ask to try to fit that person or the action in the law and see how it would fit them. And you would see that lawyers try to place the actions in the law, in the written word. And in this case, this rule applies. And in this case, this rule applies. So, okay. Okay, let's have a look at some people. Kevin Mitnick, very interesting person. I think we already talked about him. Arnim already spoke about him. He's a very famous hacker. Oh, hacker, social engineer, maybe more. This is some of the things that he did: wiretapped NSA agents. always looks good on your resume if you're a hacker. Hack Motorola, Bell, FBI, Pentagon. Why not? So yeah, he did do some decent things as a hacker. I mean, I'm not a hacker. I'm a security professional. That's it. There's was it ethical what he did? Questions that we could ask ourselves. Especially with all the script kiddies. There's a lot of scripts out there. This is just a list of a lot of scripting tools. There are all sorts of tools out there with which you can create malware. You can just click, okay, I want to do some, well, I want to decrypt cute FTP passwords and let's see what we would like to do. I don't know what kind of tool this is, but we can choose a lot of options and we can create a virus, we can create a Trojan, we can create a cracker that can crack things on the computer, that's all. And even that software in itself is a business. Now we have here a black hole. Yesterday I watched I watched Third Rock from the Sun, and Harry, I think Harry is the one, and he said at one point at one of the guys that was coming by, and the guy was not a very nice guy, and he said, "What a black hole!" Fantastic. So, and now I read this. Black hole is a tool. Commercial crimeware designed to do all the hacking for you. You could rent the kit as an online kit. You could rent it for $500 to $700 a month. And for $50 extra, it could also do crypting for you, so some extra stuff. And it was created by Pounch. This is him, a Russian guy who was arrested. So apparently it was not very ethical, it seems, or at least against the law. He also created a cool, even better tool, and you could rent it for a whopping $10,000 a month. If you create a tool like this, is that ethical? I don't know. Interesting. Because you don't do anything wrong. I mean, you just, I mean, it's a tool. This is what we are talking about. This is tools to do with, this is tools with which you create botnets and stuff. Huh? And there's script kiddies, like our Yen the White, script kiddie. He created the Anna Kournikova virus. Well, he created it in the virus within hours. Apparently, it took him a few hours to find the right checkboxes in the tool, which makes me think how good of a hacker was he. But apparently it took him only a few hours to create that virus. That's the virus. You check this, Anna Kournikova. And at that time, I mean, when this was sent 10 years ago or so, I don't know. If you had an email with Anna Kournikova JPEG, then most people would have a peek. And it was the generator, the script generator, was apparently, or they think, done by an Argentinian programmer. There's a case now in the Netherlands of Li Vu, a Vietnamese student, and he was arrested for cyber crimes, but he says it was his roommate who's now in Vietnam. What happened is from that IP address, many people in America got ripped off. I mean, their credit card details were stolen and used for criminal things. And he says it was my roommate, but his roommate is now in Vietnam. La 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 la. Eating his phar, I was told. It's a famous Vietnamese dish. Nice in the sun. And he walks with an ankle bracelet. It's a GPS thing. So that he cannot escape. And he will probably have to go to America to, I don't know, maybe for an extended stay. I don't know. He says he will prove that he's innocent. Well, good luck. The one who went before him was Benjamin Schoten. He's from the Hogeschool van Den Haag. Well, he's currently having fun in America in a prison there for a few years. 21-year-old student from the Haas Hogeschool, and he hosted the website corrupt.su for credit card. It was like a marketplace, eBay, for credit card details. And he faces 60 years in prison and a $1.5 million fine for 44,000 credit cards stolen in Seattle. The verdict is in, because this is an old slide, and the verdict is, yeah, he was sentenced today to 12 years in prison. So it won't be 60. He will be getting 12 years of, well, yeah. But he won't be alone. I'm sure he gets lots of attention and love from fellow inmates during his stay. And he won't need a green card or anything. Bangerandcorrupt.su. This is how it works. Here you can see that you could buy, for example, an airline ticket from this guy. And whatever ticket is you want, you have to pay me $250. So you say, I want a ticket to Suriname, for example. Which is, how much is a ticket to Suriname?
$800.
$800. Oh, that's not that expensive. I thought it was more expensive.
No, it's in the high season, you pay $1,200.
$1,200, yeah, that's a lot of money.
Euros.
Euros, €1,200. A whole lot of money, yeah. So, €1,200. Well, here, if you would have, I mean, it doesn't exist anymore, but you could buy it. Maybe you can try to contact him in his prison, but I don't think he has the website anymore. But you could go to this website and you could say, well, I want a ticket to Suriname, and you would pay $250, and you get your ticket. And which is a good deal for you. And he would pay, of course, the ticket with the stolen credit card. But this is how the scam worked. Of course, there's also agencies like the GCHQ from the UK in this case. There's plenty. Every country has them. This is a famous one. I like this one because, well, I like this one. I like this case, not this agency. I like it all, not at all, because I think my personal opinion. For example, they hacked the European Union, they hacked a phone company in Belgium to eavesdrop on all the phone conversations in Brussels, for example. And I'm pretty sure they also hacked the system in France as well for, what was it? It's Brussels and?
Strasbourg.
Yeah, thank you so much. Just testing. Brussels, I'm sure they hacked the one in Strasbourg as well to eavesdrop on the phone conversations, and I think that's definitely too far. But that's my personal opinion, but this is something we can all judge according to the template of how to make ethical decisions, as we will see later. They apparently thought it was not too much, and they also didn't think that looking at all the webcam information, webcam feeds of everyone worldwide, so not just in England but or UK, but also in America, also in the Netherlands, what they did for years, they tapped all the Yahoo webcams, and they took pictures every 5 minutes of the video, and they stored it. They still have all the data, and in 1 6-month period in 2008 alone, but they've been doing this for years, huh? The agency collected webcam imagery, including substantial quantities of sexual explicit communication. Yes, of course, I mean, whenever I have the webcam on, it's not because I want to see the face of the other one. I have the picture right here. Including substantial quantities of sexually explicit communications from more than 1.8 million Yahoo user accounts globally. That's global. So that's this is I talk about ethical. About is this ethical? Of course, in the Netherlands we have the same thing. We have our AIVD and the MIVD. There's the building. Singing. I like the slogan, and that's on this thing. In God we trust, everyone else we monitor. Great. In dienst van de democratie, the AIVD, sure. At service of the democracy. But this is in Europe, officially. How much the agencies eavesdrop on their residents, and you see the one in across, I mean, you cannot read it, but I know that this one is the Netherlands, and this is the other European countries. So officially, I mean, of course, this is official. I mean, I'm sure France does a lot more than they say, because France is also very active in spying on its own people, but they're just more secure about it. And we are pretty, I think, pretty open. But I don't think this is the total picture. I think there's even more than this. But it's a scary number. It's fun. In officially, in the Netherlands, the chance of your phone call being overheard by someone is, at least officially, 177 times higher than in the United States. So that says a lot about what is done here. And of course, maybe you get to work there at the AFL. If I would be offered a job there, I mean, this is not a job interview, but yeah. Might be a nice place to work, I don't know. But even if you don't get a job offer there, then maybe you have to deal with a box like this, the blue coat. And this is Arnim, I think, already told you about. But I think this came up with the talk of Oscar. Did he talk about the blue coat? Blue coat is a box that makes it possible for you to eavesdrop on encrypted information, encrypted data. So if someone thinks they have an encrypted channel, you can.
It's designed to do monitoring of your network performance and preventing data loss of your company's assets. Mm-hmm. Something like that.
So you would be asked, please make sure that nothing which is confident leaves the premises of this company. That's your question. And then you have the ethical question on how am I going to do that? Do I need gloves? Because people can hide all sorts of information in all sorts of body crevices. And do we go that way? Or do we use a blue coat, which is the equivalent of that? So you have encrypted, you have an encrypted channel to the outside world? Well, let's have a look. What's in there? Botnets, we spoke about botnets. Botnets, big issue. There's a lot out there. This is a list of what botnets are. And botnets keep being out there. I mean, they are very hard to destroy. I want to, I think the botnets are interesting for from an ethical perspective, because they bring a lot of ethical questions to how to deal with them. Because there are big nuisances. And if I become part of a botnet, bless you. Okay? One moment you have nothing, one moment you have two hands full. or the next moment, you have two hands full. Botnets, for example, they are very difficult to stay away from. I mean, they're everywhere. And now I am infected with the botnet. And now what? Because do I want to defend myself against this botnet? But if I want to defend myself, maybe I need to attack the network. But the network consists of many innocent people, many innocent devices. Because your computer could be infected with a botnet, which infects my computer. And now I take away the botnet, I protect myself, but your computer starts attacking me again. And now I go, I'm going to counterattack. I'm going to destroy your computer. Well, your whatever. And maybe I can. Hey, look at the example of the attack on the nuclear power plant or the nuclear centrifuge.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So maybe I can. But is it ethical? As you said, no. Well, that's an interesting question.
From my point of view, personal. Opinion.
It's a very difficult, for me that's a very difficult question. This is a very simple example, but the nuisance can get very extreme. Let's go to the KPN. Yeah, let's go to the KPN, and the KPN is under attack from thousands of computers every day. And I know exactly who these thousands of computers are, because I have their IP addresses. And it's very difficult to protect yourself from these thousands of computers. And these computers are unaware. So it's causing a lot of resources, maybe, for the KPN. This is just hypothetical, right? But it could cause a lot of resources for the KPN to keep all the network traffic up and to deal with it. And how much harm does a counterattack do? I mean, if I pinpoint it directly at the botnet, maybe I can kill the botnet without harming the platform itself. I don't have an answer. I'm not saying yes or no. I'm just saying this is a very difficult question. I know that there are companies out there counterattacking botnets, counterattacking innocent people. And they made the decision that no, it's not unethical to do so. But it's a very tricky question. This is, for me, botnets are very high on the list of...
The police even did it.
Yes.
And they spread antivirus software by the botnet controller.
Yeah.
De-infecting all the bots.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
So you said the police in the Netherlands did it. They spread antivirus through the same botnet through the controller, which is true. And this is a very good example. Well, the last thing I want to tell you about technical stuff, there are things called a logic bomb, where you program something nasty to happen at a certain time. And whether this is ethical or not, this is just some examples. I mean, this is funny. I mean, a similar thing is, what if I programmed my software to do harm to anyone who tries to copy my software. And this is done. I mean, people do this. And this is maybe in line with Sony's copy protection, which installed a virus on your computer, more or less. But no, let's not say a virus. It installed a rootkit. That's the word I was looking for. It installed a rootkit to make sure that you cannot copy their software and their movies. Oh, food! I would say that is unethical. But this is all. These are questions that you can encounter later when you are in your profession. You can work for Sony, and you can be asked by Sony or anyone else, create a rootkit to protect our intellectual property. And this is and this is done. This is real life examples. I see people not. So let's get back to ethics and law. And ethics is about right and wrong. It's about decisions, taking decisions, and decisions to for certain actions. What kind of actions are they? There's obligatory actions, actions that I ought to do. I should do. A child falls in the water, drowning. Should I jump in the water, save the child? But I have new sneakers. This is an ethical dilemma. Sneakers is not even my child. Parents should have been more attentive. Not let the child so close to the water. And there's someone else there as well. Not that good. I mean, worse sneakers than I have, older sneakers than I have. I can take my sneakers. I know I can take my sneakers off. But what if I jump in the water and someone steals my sneakers? Ethical questions. Okay, obligatory. It's the right thing to do. It's a less obligatory, but it's the right thing to do. Forbidden. You shouldn't do. Maybe again with a kid. You're in a line. And a kid gets in front of you in the line. Bless you.
Thanks.
And you smack it on the head. Back. Maybe you shouldn't do it. Wrong thing. This is maybe more for the Netherlands than in America, because in the Netherlands, you cannot touch your children. I think in America, smacking your kids is still a gray area. Super arrogatory. It's good, but not obligatory. It's the right thing to do, but it's not. I mean, it's not something you have to do. Sub-arrogatory. I'm trying so bad. It's bad, but it's not forbidden. So it's and permissive. It's morally acceptable. Not so much good or right. Good or bad, but it's acceptable. Well, there's a lot of theories about ethics. I already said at the beginning, we have law and ethics. And for law, you have lawyers and attorneys and people who study all these books and cases, and I'm not one of them. But I mean, it's that area of expertise. Ethics is far more about philosophy. It's these people who discuss all sorts of hypothetical cases. What if? And is there a God? Because there's also philosophers that say, well, God takes care of everything. We don't need a law system. If you kill someone, just wait until you die. You will burn in hell forever. Well, I'm 12 years in prison. Burn in hell forever seems like a it's a lot worse than 12 years in prison. I don't know. I mean, I haven't been in prison. I haven't been in hell, so not that I know. But I'm just guessing. So that's more the realm of ethics. And there's a lot of ideas. I wrote down a few of them. For example, moral universalism.
Universalism.
Right and wrong are absolute. So there's an absolute right and there's an absolute wrong. I don't really believe that personally. But that's, I mean, but there's philosophers, there's scholars out there, smart people who say no. There's something like, for example, killing a person is always wrong. You should, like the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not steal. It's always wrong. I don't know. There's people who say moral relativism, right and wrong are subjective, depends on the situation. Thou shalt not kill. Yeah, but a person is running at me, wanting to kill me, maybe, I don't know, smack me. Make not so nice love to me. also in the category of rape.
Talking about cacti.
Cacti, yeah, maybe with a cacti. Although, with my sexual preference. but let's say in this case, I don't prefer cacti being inserted in whatever areas of my body. And we would consider that rape. Then maybe it is. Maybe in that case, if I kill that person, I don't know. It's a utilitarian. I'm gonna try. Utilitarianism. I'm not gonna say that again. Right is maximizing utility. So maximizing happiness while minimizing suffering. So. This is about
cacti.
Yeah. although there's sometimes happiness connected to suffering. But you could have that view. That it's all about happiness, being happy, being in a utilitation. Happy. You can define happy very broad, right? It consists of a lot of things. So you could say that is the right thing to do. Consequentialism. If the goal is right, the method is acceptable. This is a lot of American thinking. Huh? The ends justify the means. We want to get we want to kill. What was his name?
Bin Laden.
Bin Laden. Yeah, we want to kill Bin Laden. And then we have to nuke half the world. As long as we get that guy. If the goal is right, the method is acceptable. But again, this is different views on how we should approach ethics. And which one is the right one? No one. There's no definite answer yet. There's social contracts. Social contracts is what we have in interacting each other. If someone is my friend, and my friend, he's my friend. Let's say I have a friend. And my friend is moving. Should I help my friend move? I am. It's not one of my things. I mean, if you say, well, Elmer, I need you to play 24 hours of video games with me. I'm your guy. Sure. I say, okay, let's do this. But then you say, let's move this, the washing machine or something from the third floor to my apartment on the sixth floor. Maybe I'm not your guy.
Let's get rid of this body.
Yes, let's get rid of this body. Yes. Let's get rid of this body. Maybe I'm your guy. I don't know. Well, the last one I don't dare about. That's social contracts. Things you do for your friends, things you do for your partner, things you do for, I don't know, like we feel we can, if I look at the Netherlands as a group, as a country, maybe we are probably in a social contract with for example, the Americans for the World War II, when they have an argument with, let's say, Saddam Hussein, and there's a war in the Middle East, and we say, wow, when we had those Germans over here, they helped us get rid of the Germans, always a good idea. Then there's a kind of social contract, and maybe we should do something in return. This is all part, and there is a group who says ethics is about social contracts. There's a intuitionism, which is common sense. You just said, well, this has to be the right thing. And when you have candy and you have a friend and there's a small child there, you just intuitively know this is for my friend because he's my friend. And children will get enough candy. Candy is not good for children. Sugar, better for my friend. There's also people who says there is no such thing as good and right. There's people who say that ethics. What do you mean ethics? It's all chaos. I mean, killing is neither good nor bad. Killing is killing. So there's a lot of. Well, of course, for us, we cannot really work at this because if we are in our profession, we need to make decisions and we need some form of guidance for these decisions. There is an IEEE. Yeah.
How would you call the people who don't believe in the word ethics or say there's no good or bad?
Oh, what was the term? Nihilism. I think it's nihilism. Yes. So they. You can Google it. Nihilism. But that's. But there's more than these. I mean, this is just a subset. There's more. Different views on ethics, but I believe the group that says there is no such thing, or at least there is no such thing as right or wrong. There is just it. I mean, like killing. Killing is killing. It's neither good nor bad. Which is also, I mean, if you read up on all these views, and that's why it's philosophy. They all make a valid statement. I mean, but the problem is they conflict because which statement is true? Well, and for us, this is too difficult to make decisions. We need something which works for us so that we can structure our thought. There is a IEEE code of ethics. The members of IEEE, in recognition of the importance of our technologies in affecting the quality of life throughout the world, do we all know what IEEE is? What is IEEE? It's the Institute of Electrical Engineering and another E. What? Electronics. This electrical.
Electronics.
Electrical electronics engineering. Thank you. Okay, so it's the Institute for Electrical Electronics Engineering, apparently, and it's. It's an institute that creates standards. I think standards is the right word in English. Standards for whatever. For example, they created the standards for networking, Ethernet, wireless networking, IEEE 802.3, 802.11, and so on and so on. And they make a lot of standards. So, and they also have a code of ethics, which might help us. But I would like to give you a little bit more than that. I would like to tell you that there is such a thing as culture, and there's culture at a lot of levels. There's culture at your local group, and you're part of maybe you are a member of a motorbike gang, Surandaya, Hells Angels, And that's a subculture. I don't know. This is. I don't.
No? I'm not a member.
You're not a member? No, I'm not.
Look at me.
No, but that's subgroups. Okay. The Hood. My bros in the Hood. Also a subculture. Or maybe the culture of the Netherlands as a culture. The culture of Europeans as a culture. You have cultures of, for example, Suriname. We have the Suriname culture. And what the culture is a very difficult thing. There's a culture at the HVA. We at the HVA, we are different from those people at the, in Holland. In Holland, of Windesheim. Windesheim. But we are different from these people. And we know we are different, but it's very difficult to touch. How are we different? The culture itself is very difficult to describe. If I would ask any of you, describe the Dutch culture, I don't know. We would come up with, I don't know, Geert Wilders. Is that part of the Dutch culture? I don't know. Patat. Patat, wooden shoes, French fries, wooden shoes, tulips.
Cheese.
But this is funny, because this is not the culture, but what we are describing are symbols. And this is what the cultural web is all about. The cultural web is a theory which says, or a model, in a model which says, well, the real culture is very difficult to understand. But we can understand the culture by these six factors. We can look at the symbols. We can say, for example, the Netherlands. We can say, oh, the symbols of the Netherlands. Tulips, polder, talking, Dutch. Opelkadet, is it in Dutch? I don't know.
Windmills.
Tulips, I don't know, roads, bicycles, and that's all symbols, which tells a little bit about the culture. We can look at the stories. What are cool stories that about Dutch people? They say, Dutch people, they sailed all over the world, and we kicked the ass of the British people. That's always the best one. And
we put a finger in the dike.
We put a finger in the dike, exactly. That's stories, which tells a bit about who are the Dutch people. And routines, what do the Dutch people do? Well, we eat meatloaf on Wednesday. And we always eat at 5:30 sharp, or 6 o'clock. And with our food in our lab, watching soccer at
6.
Goede tijden, slechte tijden. Yeah, routine. I mean, it's funny, but if you talk with people, there's so many things that we have in common that we all do at the same time. We all drive to work somewhere between 7 and 9 o'clock in the morning. Always. Because whenever you go on the road before 7 or after 9, empty. But from 7 to 9, everyone is parked at a highway somewhere. Same thing between 4:30 and 5:30. Same thing, we all leave. We all go on vacation. In the winter, in what is it, December? Christmas vacation, we all go to Austria, skiing. There's more people, more Dutch people in Austria at Christmas than Austrians, I believe. They're all Dutch people skiing, that's where we go. That's routines, that's what we do. Controls, how are decisions taken, who takes decisions in the Netherlands. This is funny, and this is typical for the Dutch culture, for example. In the Netherlands we take decisions together. And there's always a consensus. We don't have a strong leader like Putin. If we had Putin, the Netherlands would stretch. We would go to Las Palmas. In Zeeland. Eh? Well, that would be Zeeland. Zeeland would be extended to Morocco. Because we could use the same argument. There's a lot of Dutch people there already. If we have a referendum, would you prefer to stay with with Spain, or would you prefer to stay with Den Haag? Oh, you prefer to stay with Den Haag? Okay, bam, let's stay. too bad we don't have any tanks anymore. Yes. Of course, if we have the same analogy, then this would be Germany's beach. So it's the same problem. Power structure. Who has the power? Who has the real power in this country? Which is also funny, because I think in the Netherlands we have a lot of power. As people, we have a lot of power. I think compared to other countries, the power is pretty low in the hierarchy. Organizational structure, one of the structures, government structures. But if you look at HVA, you can look at HVA structures. You can do it with any culture, and it's interesting. And the model is very interesting because the model says it works both ways. First of all, if you look at all these things, it tells you a lot about the culture, but it works both ways. If you change these things, you can affect the culture. You can change the culture. And this is very interesting. This is fun.
Is that what they call paradigm shift?
Then you have a paradigm shift, yeah. Which is very difficult. It takes a long time. But you can... I'm a strong believer in this model. I mean, again, this is... There's out of 10 people, there's 50 opinions on this model, of course, but I am a strong believer in this model. I think it works very well. And I think it works especially if you have, for example, KPN as a company, and you would like to change the culture within the company, you can affect parts of this. And this is also used, for example, if you want to change subcultures, or if you... if you have a certain subculture and you want to change the paradigm within that, you can manipulate these issues. Then values and norms. That was the Harry Potter, eh? Our last president. Is it the prime minister? Balkenende. He was always talking about values and norms. Values is a very broad thing. It's a generalization of value. Huh? Like here, respect. We have respect for each other. I'm not saying we have respect. I mean, I give it as an example, as a value. But let's say we have respect for each other. We are responsible. Huh? We are responsible for our actions. Let's say we care for each other. We are honest. Yeah. Nice though. I'm not saying, like, again, it's an example. But this is not smart. This is not... does that work in English as well? It's a Dutch term, maybe? Specific? Yes, specific.
Measurable.
Acceptable.
Acceptable.
Realistic.
Realistic.
Time
constraint, huh? Yeah. It's a Dutch. I don't know if they use it in English in other countries, but we use smart. Huh? It's specific and measurable and acceptable and realistic and time constraint. This is not smart. This is not something I can measure. This is not something that I can make laws upon. So, for example, I can say we respect the law. We can say that, but. What is respecting the law? Is it if I drive 1 kilometer over the speed limit, am I done violating the law? Am I still respecting the law? Well, the norm when it comes to speed limits, sadly in the Netherlands, we're pretty strict. Huh? 3 kilometers over, bam, ticket. This is what I like about America. I mean, that you cannot even measure it. The car has an indication of while you're driving a more or less 60 miles an hour. But so it's you're a lot safer. But here you need to know exactly. So you drive 102, bam, fine. But in other things. In the Netherlands, we are not so strict. We say, well, you shouldn't do this. You shouldn't, I don't know. You shouldn't
What? Who?
Jaywalk. Jaywalk.
Jaywalk! Ah, it's jaywalking, exactly. You shouldn't jaywalk, but do you ever get a fine? Even if you shoot someone, hey, you shouldn't shoot someone.
Blah, blah.
In the law, you can get, you can go to prison for life. The Netherlands is one of the few countries where you can actually go to prison for life. Amnesty International is very much against that, because even in America, you have the option for appeal. But in the Netherlands, if you get sentenced to life, it means you never get out of jail. I mean, that's there's no a possibility of appeal, which is so that don't get that. But it's very difficult to get, because even if you kill someone, then there's always it was the weather, and he slept bad, and he took a pill, he took some medication, and. Don't do it again in 6 months. And that's all about norms. And that's all about norms, about what, how do we interpret the values. And this is a sad picture, but this comes back to this view, and this is why I don't believe in this one. There's an absolute right and wrong. And exactly this picture depicts what my problem is with that. Thou shalt not steal. But what if you have no food? And what if someone else has so much food that they waste it? Like we had.
Kill them.
It's a tricky one. It's a tricky one. I would say I don't see I don't see an ethical problem, at least, with stealing in that case. But this is of course, if you say sure, they should not steal, Sharia, chuck, hands off. I don't know, that's all decisions that you should take. Okay, this is almost a story. I have a case for you to have a look at, and then we will take some time for that so you can look at the case. We will stay here for the lab exercises as well, and so we will. I hope we will be we finish early today, because we stay here together. We have for ethics, we have three labs here, and we will start now with one lab, and we can take a short break as well while we are doing that. So let's say we continue a quarter to four. So in 40 minutes, and in that 40 minutes you can go have a short pit stop, maybe smoke a bit, and work on your first assignment. After this assignment, we have two more slides to give you a review of this assignment, and after that we have the last assignment, which is the final assignment for today, and we will discuss it. But there's two more slides. This is the first. Okay. Yeah, we can stop. Yeah. Thank you for your attention. And let's do the first one. Huh?